Righto, guys. Good morning. Welcome. Great to have young folk here. Excellent.
Thanks, Russell.
Yeah. Pleasure.
You're welcome.
And their children. With children. Well, we feel especially blessed because we have our tamariki here with us. Quill and Caspian sitting here in the front row, watching Granddad do his thing. So wonderful to have you guys here. Very cool. And of course, they are going to be living here, which is going to be wonderful. So there's the welcome to you all. Shall we invite the Holy Spirit to come now? Stand, sit, however you feel led. Father God, we make a conscious decision this morning to open our hearts to your leading as we gather before you, as we take this time aside and focus on you. We ask, Lord, by your grace to open our eyes to see things as you see them, to open our hearts to receive things that you have for your kids. Come, Holy Spirit. Touch us afresh this morning. Thank you, Lord. don't know if this means anything to anyone, but about 6 or 8 months ago, I had the privilege of going for a flight with a friend of mine who's a pilot. And we flew from Nelson Airport. We were flying down over Adel Island, and we're heading down towards Adel Island in this wee Cessna. And he said, "Do you want to fly?" Well, he had already asked me if I wanted to take off, if I wanted to. I said, no. Anyway, when we got down to Adel, and there's a point to this story, by the way, when we got down to Adel, he said, "Do you want to fly?" And I said, "That'd be amazing." Now, what pilots do is they say, when they take control of the aircraft, they say, "I have control." And the co-pilot responds by saying, "You have control." So they're acknowledging that each other is, right? And I just felt for someone here this morning that the Lord is saying to their hearts, "I have control over this." And that, well, it might be me. And the Lord wants the response, "You have control." So if it's not me, I'm saying it in my heart now, but if it's not me, if it's someone else, then the Lord's saying, "I have control over whatever the situation is." And he just wants us to say, "You have control." So there we are. Gary, do you have a Makariya phone for me down there, please? Anyone have anything they would like to share of what the Lord's been doing in their lives, in their space this week? Anyone at all? Scripture, there's all these scriptures are now running through my head at the moment, like things such as the rain falls on the righteous and the unrighteous. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away, blessed be the name of the Lord. And this next song, so I like to have everything sorted by Thursday if I possibly can. And I'm just telling you that simply because the song that the Lord wanted me to do on Thursday that we're going to do now is quite profoundly prophetic as we stand and we sing together, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God.
Lord, great is your faithfulness. Father, all through Scripture, when great things happen, we are reminded of the outcome of your promises of the past. You said this and that happened. You said that and this happened. Therefore, we can trust for today that when you say something will happen, it will. Great is your faithfulness to each of us. You're a good, good God who loves his kids. Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, when your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
So if he's for us, then who can be against us? that your name is to be shouted from the rooftops this Christmas. Christ with us, Emmanuel. Blessed be your name above all names. God's word is a light to our paths, Scripture says. It's a light in this dark, dark world. God's word is a lamp, and a lamp you don't keep under a bushel. A lamp you use to expel the darkness, to fill in the void of godlessness. Thanks, Gary. Let's just sing this a cappella.
Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire.
Please be seated. Thank you. So we all know what season we're going into. Coming to the end of, really. It's next week, isn't it? It's next week. So just by and by, I'm just wondering how uncomfortable it would have been for Mary riding on a donkey. But I'm not allowed to talk about that any longer. Yeah. I'm not allowed to talk about there's no donkey in the Nativity story. So here we are. We're going to read all this together and then I'm going to pray. It's quite a chunk of scripture this morning, but I believe that this is so vitally important. Here we go. Let's all read together.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. and exists in the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the high country to a town in Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And wise is granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me. For behold, and the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord.
Father God, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, for the reminder this Christmas of the coming of the Christ child. As we contemplate what that might mean for us all these years later. So come Holy Spirit, move our hearing from our head down into our heart. Amen. So I don't know why this isn't working. Is it plugged in? Anyway, you just have to follow me, Gary. So I'm just going to look at four scriptures in the big passage that we just read. I'm only going to look at four scriptures. So here's the first one. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And the second scripture that I'm going to look at is, Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the third one, In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town in Judah, and she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And the fourth one, And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. So just put the next one up, Gary, and just leave it there, it'll be good. So that's the four scriptures that I'm going to look at this morning. So as we contemplate those passages, what do those passages sound like to you? And I was particularly moved, and I put it before everyone here this morning. Do they remind you of anything that has happened in your life? Do they remind you of anything that has happened if you're in your life? If not, that's perfectly okay. But does it make you wonder what I may be referring to? If you have had an experience like the greeting of Mary and Elizabeth, praise the Lord. If you haven't, maybe you're thinking, what is he talking about? Could you be wondering what happened to Mary or even to Elizabeth might have any bearing on your life? I mean, these events were over 2,000 years ago. And as I've got written here. And what happened to Mary doesn't happen to us blokes. I have no idea what it's like to carry a child. Sadly, not all women do either. But for those who do know what it's like to carry a child, I'm just saying I don't. So I don't know what was really happening with Mary and Elizabeth. Well, let's be honest. I'm still being challenged as to why this passage resonates with me so. I don't know about you, but why does this passage, why does, and when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leapt in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Why does that resonate so much in my life And I'm leaving it up there that you may be considering the same thing for yourselves. Is there any sort of resonation with what's happening? To understand what the Spirit may be saying to the church, well, we heard that before, over and over and over in a liturgical service, hear what the Spirit's saying to the church. Well, let's listen, shall we, to what the Spirit's saying to the church. We need to look at, I believe, other examples, similar examples to what we're reading here, similar examples in Scripture. And I'm going to look at only three of them. There are very many. But I'm going to look at three influential people, and these are three pivotal people in this love story that we call the Bible. And the three people that I'm going to look at this morning is Jacob, Moses, and Stephen. First of all, let's have a look at Jacob. Jacob, to put the little passage that we're going to look at in context, Jacob and Esau had a falling out. They're brothers, and they had a falling out many years before. And Jacob has just found out that his brother Esau was nearby. And what Jacob wanted to do was he wanted to reconcile with him. And he wanted to do it with all sincerity. And so he gathered this massive gift of animals and valuables to show his remorse. And he was traveling to see him, to see Esau. He had just crossed the river and they were camped there for the night. So we're reading now from Genesis 32, 24. Thanks, Gary. So let's read this together, shall we?
And Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day has broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip.
Three things speak to me out of that story. First of all, Jacob's sincerity and his desire to seek forgiveness and reconciliation with his brother. Now, even if we haven't got a brother that we need to seek forgiveness and reconciliation with, whenever we come near the Spirit of God, I certainly feel that he is holy, and too often I've dropped the ball, and all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We're not icky people, we just are, right? We're human. So I certainly feel, understand Jacob's sincerity and his desire to reconcile with Esau. So that's the first thing that speaks to me in the story. The second that speaks to me in the story is that Jacob was wrestling with God and not wanting to stop until God showed favor to him. He would not stop interacting with God until God showed him favor. And the third, and I think most powerful one, is that God touched Jacob in such a way that A, he never walked the same again. After encountering God, he never walked the same again. And when he encountered God, he came away from there with a new identity. He never walked the same again, and he came away from the interaction with God with a new identity. So that's the first one. Building on that, we now go to Exodus 34. Let's read this together. When Moses
came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand as he came down from the mountain. Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, and behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him.
So a little bit of background on this story as well, because as I've said, friends, Scripture needs to be read in some kind of context. If you go back two chapters in the Exodus story, what's happened is that Moses has already been up the mountain and received what we know as the Ten Commandments on two tablets of stone. And when he came down from being up on the mountain, the people of God had got so frustrated with Moses having been away such a long time, they thought, well, he's not coming back. So if he's not coming back and he said that he was going up to see God, but what was he really? And now he's gone, and now he's not. We need to try and sort something out for ourselves. So they went to Aaron, who was Moses' 2IC, went to him and said, hey, Aaron, can you collect up all the jewelry that we have amongst us, and let's make a golden calf and let's worship before that? Because this man, Moses, ain't coming back. No matter what he says, he's not coming back. Where have we heard that before? Jesus said, I will return. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come back and I will take you to where I am. And yet humanity seemed to have replicated what happened in Exodus 32 and said, Jesus coming back? Don't think so. Let's create our own gods. Cars and boats and houses and careers. Cyclical. Round and round and round we go. So what happened was that Moses did come back down the mountain with the Ten Commandments, saw what the people were up to, and got so angry that he smashed them on the ground and destroyed them. And was actually, him and God, it was not going to look good for the people of Israel. In fact, the scripture says this: when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered themselves together. This is where they make the calf. Come, make us gods who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. So Moses got so angry that he smashed the original tablets. And here we have him now with the second law. The people are far more subdued by now and they're willing to behave. However, there are consequences to all we do. And if we don't think that there's consequences today to our actions, then we're living a life of folly. Because there are consequences to our actions and to our decisions. That's why God's gathered us together this morning and other mornings to hear his word, because he's saying, careful what path you're going down. Stick with the plan that I have for you, because the plan is ideal for how I created you. So for that generation, the generation that had made the golden calf, the consequence of their action was that they would never see the promised land. So the whole generation that came out of Egypt never got to see the promised land except for two. Story for another day. We are quick to blame God for bad things that happen to us, and so often those bad things are through our own stupid decisions. So Moses had this encounter with God, and when he came down, his face was so bright that he had to veil it, because people couldn't look upon his face because they knew of their sinfulness and they were afraid to come near him. So the third person is Stephen. Thanks, Gary. So let's read this together. This is from the book of Acts. It's chapter 6 and it's verse 14. And the Pharisees and Sadducees have had enough of all these followers of the way. They were still upsetting the people. Thousands were flocking into this new faith to follow Jesus, and they'd had enough, so they had Stephen, who was one of the apostles, brought before them, and they were going to deal with them. So let's read together. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and change the customs Moses handed down to us. All who were sitting in the Sanhedrin looked intently at Stephen, and they saw that his face was like the face of an angel. Because Stephen was having this close encounter with God. So friends, where's this going? Mary bore Christ within her very being. She carried Christ within her. We can't do that as she did. First of all, us blokes certainly can't. And Mary's already carried Jesus, so we're not going to physically bear him again. We can't do that as she did, pregnant with his God-human. And yet Scripture says, and I looked it up, over 100 times Scripture says about the ability, the opportunity, the gift, and the power of each individual being filled with the same Spirit that was in Christ. Over 100 times Scripture talks about the ability, the opportunity, the gift, and the power of being filled by the very Spirit of God. Too often as humans, we dwell on the physical. Yet occasionally only we consider the spiritual. The world does this really easily. This consideration of power, the power of the Spirit that should be in us, the world do it really easily. And here's some of the things that they hold and call authority. Police, doctors, military leaders, teachers, parking wardens, thanks Gary, yes, and even pastors. Have an authority that they carry. We understand it, and generally we obey it. But God has his Spirit that we also can carry, but this Spirit is radically different. The Spirit is from God. The Spirit is God himself in spirit form, infilling his creations, and if allowed, that's why this morning I said we're going to make a tangible decision to welcome the Holy Spirit to dwell within us this morning. If allowed, God will act through us by his Spirit. The world do this easily. One of my pet memories is when I used to be a sales rep driving on the road. One of my pet memories of reacting to authority as you're driving along, especially if I was on the open road, and then suddenly out behind you there's a car with blue flashing lights on the back, right? My immediate reaction, look at your speedo, look at your warrant, and then he pulls up and passes me because he's off to something else. But see, that there's my insecurity, or this one, and I don't know why, because I don't drink and drive. But as soon as I see a checkpoint, your gut goes, or is it just me? Please don't tell me it's just me. Oh, goodness, it's just me, Anna. It's just me. Oh, no. Anyway. So my stomach drops and it turns into knots, and it happens every time I see it. It can't get my head around. So the question is this. And I'll finish with this. The question is this, surely. As we consider what happened between Mary and Elizabeth, and Mary was carrying the Christ child, and Elizabeth was carrying who was to become John the Baptizer, and that she says that this baby leapt in her womb when Mary came near. Look at the look on her face, though. Oh, by the way, the Mary lady is a New Zealand actress. think of her name in a minute. Dadaloo, that's it. Well done, dear. But look at the look of joy on the lady who's playing Elizabeth. And then we heard of Jacob, who said, I'm not letting you go until you bless me. And he never walked the same, and he left that time with God with a different identity. Moses spent time in God's presence, and his face shone so much that the people couldn't bear to look at him. And then Stephen, as he was about to become the first martyr, his face shone like that of an angel. So saints, this Christmas, as we head towards the celebration of Emmanuel, God with us, if we profess to carry Christ in us, does the Spirit that others are carrying leap with joy when we come near? Or does our spirit leap with joy when they come near? I'd like just for a few minutes, just for you to chat amongst that amongst yourselves. When we go somewhere, do people say to us, I don't know what you've got, but whatever you've got, I want some of that? Or when we meet with someone who carries Christ in their hearts, do we go, oh, it just feels so good to be in your presence? Just chat amongst yourselves whether that happens. And if so, let's celebrate it. If not, let's wonder why not. Let's wonder about this. Just for a few minutes. So, and this isn't mandatory, just we gather back together. But if anyone wants to share anything about... I really hope the question that I posed this morning is just something that we can wonder about, ponder, consider. If not, why not? If so, why so? So has anyone got anything they'd like to share regarding that? We don't have to. Daryl, thanks, mate.
I was sharing this sort of thing happens mostly over a cup of coffee with me and with somebody else, and just the number of times different people I've been talking with, and there's been something that they have spoken or something that they've carried that I feel like has just touched my heart, and I can't put it into words. Mm-hmm. But going away going, well, thank you God, you were just in the middle of that. Mm. And I think one thing that's actually helped that become more is my a changed attitude that says, God, show me God and other people. You know, whether they even know God or not, show me your treasures that this person has. And I might even be going with the intention of serving or helping them, mm. but part of me is saying, God, I know you've got something for me mm. in the middle of this. Mm. And so that has helped me to have those well moments of going, oh, God, I just feel so blessed by that person. Mm. So. Mm,
mm, mm. Absolutely. Could I see a hand? To share something? If you want to.
Sure. Put me on the spot, please. What came forward our minds in our little group was the feel we have when we go to home group. Because my home group's back in Nelson from my old church. And so I drive over there after work every second Tuesday just to be with the girls, because I just feel, God within our relationships, you know, the love and the warmth and just learning scriptures and things together. And I've become quite close with those girls. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I just, and I just loved what you said too, because it's so true. You can feel God, like I'm a kindergarten teacher, but with children as well, you know, the innocence and the love of children. Mm-hmm. And, so I'm really lucky to be in a career where I feel that with children a lot.
thank you. Home group, meeting other than here, is so valuable. It's where the rubber hits the road. I've had more, like you're talking about, far more of those experiences and closeness of God in a home group. Or last Wednesday up at Lynn Canton's, a few of us went up to Lynn Canton's last Wednesday. What a special time, yeah? And so that real, not saying that, don't hear me, you know, but absolutely, in that intimacy where you're close friends, where you're walking through life together, they happen all the time, over coffee, rather than maybe sitting in a wooden pew looking at the back of someone's head. It's very powerful. Anyone else? We used to go to a Christian conference and we'd come back to church, the church we were at the time, full of the Spirit, just so excited about what God's doing, and people going, there, just calm down, you'll get over it. Well, the funny thing is, I'd like to know who got over what, actually, now that time goes on, but that'll be it for me to say anything. So if we profess to carry Christ in us, does the Spirit being carried in others leap when we meet? The prophet Joel said that in the last days I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Not the Christians or the church, but all flesh. Therefore, saints, making a deduction here that I believe is based on experience, I believe that there are very possibly thousands of people in this town whom the Spirit is touching, and they're not sure what it is, but they know there's something happening. They know there's something happening. Look at the Starlight Parade. The organisers said there was somewhere around 7,500 people on that parade. And if anyone's seen the photos I put up on Facebook, I put up a photo of the crowd. The crowd was really deep. They saw and witnessed and sung along with the combined churches of Motueka as we led that out. So I'm convinced that the Spirit of God is touching people in here. And if the Spirit is already moving in the lives of others in our community, and He is, don't be thinking it's all about us church people. That the Spirit would be nudging. It is nudging them. And praise the Lord that He loves them so much that He sent His one and only Son. I'll put it another way, and this is my prayer that I leave with you, if you like. Lord, let's pray. Lord, I ask that when we meet with others, when we meet with those your Spirit is trying to get the attention of, when we carry you into this community, as we profess that we do, that people will wonder what it is that makes us appear so different. That they can say, I don't know what it is, but I'm not leaving until I get what you have. Lord, that others will wonder why their heart leaps when you draw near to them. Help us, Lord, to have the right words and the gospel invitation ready, and to find you leaping in our hearts. Father God, I thank you for all that you are doing this Christmas season, as it helps us focus on you coming near. Give us interruptions. Give us divine appointments. As Daryl so wonderfully put it, give us opportunities to have conversation over coffee about you that will make sense to those we're talking to. Not gobbledygook churchianity, but the reality of the love that a father has for his creation. Help us in Jesus' name. Amen. And again, let us sing that song, Gary. Shine,
Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire.
Before you died, as you prepared to leave us so that your spirit could come, as you needed to leave that beacon of light for each of us, you took a loaf of bread, and when you'd given thanks, you gave it to them and said, "This is my body, it's given for you." He said, "Take and eat it, all of you. Do this to remember me." And then as you took the cup of wine, you reminded them that it was your blood that was poured out for those near and for those far off, poured out for all flesh, for the forgiveness of sins. Your sacrificial blood of the new covenant, the new promise. He said, "Drink this, all of you. Do this to remember me." So I thank you, Father, that we can gather here this morning. I thank you, Lord, that we can recall the goodness of your sacrifice for us. A sacrifice that throws wide the doorway into the very throne room of God. And we thank you, Father, that every time we gather together, whether it be here or in our homes, in the cafes or the restaurants, on the beaches, in the parks, that we can remember that you loved us and love us and will continue to love us and those that you send us to. So thank you, Lord. As you can see, oh, it is. How about that? I think there is a rescue mission going on. It's fine. Jesus did sacrifice himself for us. And as we come forward this morning, so he gave of himself. He gave all that he had. God says that all that I have, I give to you. And he encourages us. So, oh, you guys are amazing. He encourages us and reminds us that all that we have belongs to him. And so as we take this wonderful supper, sacrificial meal together, we have our koha box here at the front. If you've come prepared this morning, please avail yourself of that. It's okay if you haven't, that's fine. But we'll place it there. It's on the Lord's table, and please avail yourselves of that. But God has invited you here this morning to receive from him, so please come and receive. Again, thank you so much, Anna and Eleanor. It's all right, I padded it out, Anna.
Thank you.
No worries, good as gold, thank you, that's good. Please come. Please come. See you.
good to be family, isn't it? It's good to be family. It's good to be like that. It's okay. Dinner's going to be about 5 minutes late. The spuds aren't quite ready yet. That's kind of what's happened. So, here we go.
Gave us grace and opened the gate of the world.
May we who share Christ's body live as risen life. We who drink this cup bring life to us. We who survive God to the Lord. Give us firm the hope you set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen.
Amen. Philippa, do you want to share? Yes, you can share. Do you want to share anything this morning?
Missy Church on Tuesday. So come along if you can. Carol, do you need some extra help in the kitchen this week?
There was some talk that I was going to be half of a pantomime donkey, but that's not going to happen. We couldn't work out which part I was going to be. So there's our service times for next weekend. So Saturday night we have a 11:30 service. So as we come to our final song for this morning, and as we acknowledge that Jesus came to lead us back to God, let's ask him in this final song, as he leads us back into the presence of God, and as that then encourages us to take that same message into this community, then let's ask this morning that we take God's vision of what he wants to do here with us and share his good news as we share, "Be thou my vision."
Say our final prayer together.
We thank you, Lord, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Help us to be of good courage. Hold fast to what is to good, to render no one evil than evil, to strengthen the weak, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor everyone, and love and serve the Lord. We are here this day, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Go and end this. Bless you, saints. Hope to see you all next weekend.